And we're live.
Yes.
Hi there. Good morning, good afternoon, good evening, wherever it is that you happen to be in the world. Thank you for taking part of your day out to join us. This is introduction to programming using Python. Today we're very pleased, very thrilled actually, to be joined by Susan Ibach. I am Christopher Harrison. What we're going to do is introduce ourselves. We'll go ahead and talk about what we're going to talk about, and then roll on into module one, where we'll start digging in a little bit into the concept of becoming a developer and in using Python for that. So, Susan, if you want to go ahead and introduce yourself.
Sure, yeah. My name is Susan Ibach, and I am a technical evangelist at Microsoft Canada, and I've been coding for more years than I care to admit. as I like to put it, it's remarkable of a number, given the fact that I'm 29, the fact that I have over 40 years of coding experience.
That's pretty impressive.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's... I'm no math major, but that doesn't seem to work out quite right to me.
Maybe I'm mixing decimal and hexadecimal numbers
or something. Okay, there we go.
But anyway, so I'm from Microsoft Canada. I've been coding for years, and I spent a lot of time showing people how to code and teaching people how to code. So really, in this course, what we're going to be doing is really taking people through the basics so they can get comfortable with the world of programming.
Absolutely, absolutely. And as for me, I am Christopher Harrison. I'm a longtime MCT and recently took a job here, actually just over 3 months ago, which it's flown by. It's pretty crazy. It seems like I just went through orientation like about 2 weeks ago. But in any event, they hired me in to do content development. I've done a good handful of MVAs. I've been programming since my father brought home a VIC-20 and Commodore 64.
Oh, see, now I had a TRS-80.
You had a TRS-80.
64K expanded memory.
Whoa!
Yeah.
Wow.
And I ran out of memory on my program that basically said, you are entering a hallway where you turn right or left.
Yep.
You know, you turn right, you see the monster, and turn left, you found the treasure, and I actually ran out of memory with that program.
That's crazy. There was a day I remember punching in one little basic program where the shortcut for print was question mark, which you still see in certain places, and you had to use question mark, because otherwise, again, you would run out of memory. So, yeah, pretty crazy. But with that level of experience that we have between the two of us, this is why we're so excited to try and bring more people into the world of programming. I would also mention, just kind of as a real quick aside, and you'll notice it down at the bottom periodically, is that Susan's Twitter handle is Hockey Geek Girl, and my Twitter handle is Geek Trainer. You can actually see that right
cool.
down there.
Oh, that's cool. Here we
there.
Go. Yeah.
Yeah, right down there. Yep. So there may or may not be spaghetti.
Can I do pinch and zoom? It's not a touch. It's not connected by Kinect.
In any event. So, but yeah. So what do you say we kind of roll on into it? I think we've sort of introduced ourselves and our personality a fair amount there. So let's go ahead and talk about what we're going to talk about. So if we, take a look at our course topics here. Module one, getting started. So one of the big things, and we'll talk about this in module one, is the experience level that we're going for is none, no experience.
Yep.
And so we want to talk about kind of why you should get into programming, why Python, etc. And then we're going to start off with the basics in module two of displaying and manipulating text, which is probably the biggest thing you're going to be doing on a day-to-day basis.
It comes up all the time. And the other thing I really want to show is as we do each one of these modules, you'll be able to do something you couldn't do before.
Mm-hmm.
And we want you to have fun as we're going. I mentioned that first program I wrote was a sort of choose-your-own-adventure where, you know, you're going down a hallway. Do you turn right or left? I enjoyed coding because I was having fun with it. So we really do want to have some fun along the way, but have you literally feel that at the end of every module, you go, okay, wait, I can do something more with my code than I could do before. So even if you're starting from complete scratch, at the end of each module, you're going to go, wow, okay, I couldn't do that before, and you'll see yourself progressing as we go along.
Exactly. Yeah, take that next step.
Yeah.
And so speaking of taking that next step, the next step after displaying text is starting to work and manipulate string values and variables. So we'll introduce how you can actually store a string and also how you can manipulate it, work it, tweak it, and make it do kind of what you want it to do.
Right. And then we'll jump into numbers because a lot of the things we need to do with code when we're trying to solve problems and things do require some number crunching. So we'll get into numbers after that.
Yep. And then from there, since we've done numbers, dates is sort of the next logical one. So we'll take a look at how to get in and play around with and deal with dates and deal with how to enter updates.
Oh yeah. Well, let's worry about that when we get there. Okay.
All right. We'll worry about that later.
You'll learn why all programmers have a love-hate relationship with dates. Decisions with code. That little choose your own adventure program I wrote all those years ago. You are in a hallway. Do you turn right or left? If they choose right, then have them go battle a monster. If they choose left, then show them the incredible treasure they found. That's decision making with your code. So we're going to cover a module giving you an understanding of how you can branch off and follow different paths in your code based on decisions you need to make.
You realize at some point here today, I'm going to wind up downloading Zork.
We may need to do that.
Go north. In any event, the last module that we're going to cover today, and this is a very big point here, is that this is going to be a two-day event. So we've got 14 modules, 7 a day, across 2 days. So you've got us for 2 days of Python goodness here. The last module that we're going to finish out with is what we're calling complex decisions with code, which is really just taking your if statements kind of to the next level, adding in, well, if they did this, okay, well, maybe I want to do something, but if they did something else, then maybe I want to do something different. So we can go in and see how to do that with our complex decisions in code.
Yep.
And that will close off day one.
Yeah, exactly.
And then day two, we'll keep digging in. So in day two, we'll take a look at repeating events, aka loops.
Yep.
And we'll take a look at the different types of loops that are available. And again, just like with our if statements, our conditional code, we broke that across two modules. We're going to break our loops across two different modules and how to go through a list, which will actually lead us perfectly.
Yeah, because
module 10.
Absolutely, because module 10 is where we're going to talk about sometimes we need to deal with a lot of information,
mm-hmm.
and you don't just need to keep track of one thing, you need to keep track of think of it like a shopping list. You know,
exactly.
You go to the grocery store, you don't carry 10 pieces of paper, each which has written on it one thing you need to buy at the grocery store. You make a list. We do the same
thing
when we're writing code. So
yep.
we're going to talk about that, and then we're going to talk about, you know, and again, coming back to the shopping list mm-hmm. analogy, shopping list is only useful if you can, you know, write it down and bring it with you to the grocery store. So
yep.
we're going to talk about how do you save information so you can look it up later in module 11.
Yep.
And in module 12, we'll talk about once you've saved that information, how do I look it up again when I need it?
Yeah, which is sort of perfect. And again, kind of going back to the point that Susan made earlier, that we really do want to build this in a way that you can feel like you're making the next step. You'll notice that we're going to start with, hey, this is how you write to a file.
Yep.
So that way you've learned how to do that. And then we'll come back with reading from that exact same file. So that way you can see both sides of that and build into that. The next module after working with files is going to be module 13, which is functions, which is basically how you're going to take blocks of code and give it a name and be able to call it over and over and over again, which is going to help simplify your code and really simplify your life so that way you're not just constantly copy-paste.
Though having said that, let's be honest. As a programmer, I promise you will do a lot of copy-paste, and copy-paste, because if you are going to be a true coder, you need to be lazy.
We'll teach you how to be lazy.
We will. That's, we are going to show you all our favorite lazy coder programmer
absolutely,
tricks.
Absolutely. Yeah. You're dealing with two lazy people here.
Yes.
We're going to teach you how to be lazy.
Yeah.
And then last but not least, now granted, Susan, maybe you're a little bit different than I am. I know I never make mistakes.
Oh, no. I type everything perfectly every time.
Perfectly.
Oh, yeah.
Yep.
Never make mistakes.
Exactly. You know, but on that rare time.
I'm just moving while the lightning strikes.
Yeah, exactly. but on that rare moment, when something does happen, we'll talk about how you can deal with that and how you can handle those errors.
Yeah. And then we'll actually have, we won't get into the detail of it here, but we're going to have sort of one of the most important things about coding as you get into it is to mm-hmm. practice it, to try it, and to try and solve different problems. So we're going to give you little challenges to do after each of our modules. And then when the whole course is over, we're going to throw you a doozy. And say, here's one for you to go try.
Yep.
And we're not going to go through the whole thing here and show you step by step that last final challenge, but we did give you a copy of the solution in GitHub later. So if you get stuck, you have somewhere to look at it. So we're going to give you homework as we go through this and when the course is over so you can keep practicing and trying things out, because that really makes a difference. You cannot do it unless you practice. It's like learning a spoken language.
Exactly.
If you want to learn Italian or German or Chinese, if you don't practice it, you lose that ability.
Exactly. Yep. Yeah. I always like to say that I took 4 years of French in high school, and not that I would expect to be fluent after 4 years of high school French, but I'd like to think I could at least carry on a broken conversation, and I can basically, you know, ma grand-mère est flambée et la singe est disparu.
Très bien.
Yes. Go. Yeah, my grandmother's on fire and the monkey has disappeared.
Very useful.
Which, yes, doesn't get you very far. And the reason that all of that went away is because of the fact that I didn't use it. I didn't practice it. So that's going to be one big thing that we're going to talk about throughout all of this, is you have to get in, you have to play with it, you have to practice it, you have to get your hands dirty.
Yeah,
you know? That's really, really the key.
Absolutely.
Yeah. So with that, let's talk a little bit about you. I mean, we've talked an awful lot about us. We've talked an awful lot about what we're going to be talking about. Let's talk a little bit about you, about expectations, and kind of who this course is geared towards. So if you take a look at the slide, what you're going to notice, and I want to highlight that first little part there, if you're new to programming, you're in the right place.
Yes.
If you're a student.
Sure.
Who's maybe kind of looking around and going, you know, I'm trying to figure out what I want to do with my life.
Or I meet lots of business students who
yeah.
have a, you know, they're not taking programming courses, but they have an interest in getting into coding.
Exactly.
Or, you know, people in a computer science program, they're going to get lots of this material. But there's a lot of people who aren't in a computer science type program, but still have an interest in
yeah.
getting into coding. You know, they want to learn how to be better in Excel. I mean,
yes.
you know, do need yep. tricks in that.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
You know, or maybe you're kind of going, hey, I want to start figuring out what all of this coding stuff is all about. And I'm looking for a new career. You know, or maybe you're an IT pro.
This is true. This is one of those ones where, you know, there was a time where the people who were administrating our systems, they would be, you know, managing things, and they never touch code. That line has really blurred.
It really has. Yeah, you
PowerShell and scripting is
exactly.
really fitting into things. And even I was looking at some new tools in Visual Studio for release management to help you manage releasing code from mm-hmm. one place to another. And I've had this discussion with developers is, who writes the scripts to migrate code from place A to place B? Is that the developer, because it's code, or is that the administrator, because they know all of a servers and where things are moving around.
Right.
So that line between who's an administrator and who's a coder is really blurring.
It really is. It really is that basically everybody, if you're going to be in some form of a tech field, you need to be able to write some level of code.
Yeah.
And Python's a great place to start. And which sort of closes it all off with anyone that has an interest in learning to code.
Yeah.
So you'll notice here as we're setting our target audience, there's one consistent theme throughout all of this. No experience required. That is what or who this course is built for. So if you've never written a line of code, you're in the exact right spot.
Yes. Though I do want to point out, if you're
yeah.
someone who's looked at the course and said, oh, well, I've done some programming in another language and I'm fairly comfortable with coding mm-hmm. and I came to this course to learn Python specifically.
Yep.
One of the things you can do is all the challenges we created and all the slides are up on the GitHub.
Yep, and we'll show off how to get to that in a couple of minutes.
Absolutely,
yep.
we'll show you yep. how to get there. So one of the things you can do, if you want, feel free to stick around, follow along, you know, review some of the basic
yep.
concepts, review, you'll see all the syntax. But if you find yourself going, oh, wow, I know all the concepts in this module, I just kind of want to jump ahead. Hey, you know what? We're being nice. We've thrown all the slides, all the challenges. We've even created a Word document, which is just sort of summarizes every command we're going to cover.
Exactly.
So you yep. can take an accelerated version at home if you prefer, because you find the pace is too much reviewing what you already know.
Yep.
But by all means, feel free to stick around, review some of your basic concepts, and you've
exactly.
got that option as well.
Yeah. Now, if you are looking to follow along, because of course, if you're going to do code, you've got to, you know, do code.
Practice.
Yes.
Practice, practice. How do you get to, what is it,
Carnegie Hall?
Practice, 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 practice.
Practice.
Yeah.
Yep. Yeah, you got to get in and do it. So if you are wanting to follow along, you're going to need some form of a tool with which to create and work with your Python code. And in theory, I suppose you could fire up Visual Notepad, bring back VI, and do it that way. The tool that we're going to be using is Visual Studio and the Python tools in Visual Studio. So you will want to go off and install those. We will be talking a bit about how to do that in an upcoming slide. And I would also mention again on this mystical, magical GitHub that we're going to talk about in a few minutes, that there is a Word document that Susan put together that will walk you through where to go to download and install everything. So that way, if you are hopefully wanting to follow along, then you can go off and grab those tools.
Absolutely, yep. PyTorch tools.codeplex.com is where you find all, you can also find a number of instructions and information about the Python tools for Visual Studio, which we'll be using inside this session.
Exactly. Yep. Which leads us into a little bit of kind of interacting. So two big things that I want to mention. Number one, of course, the MVA community. Over 2 million registered users, which is pretty amazing. You can get 50 points for watching this event. You'll notice the little link there, aka MVA.
Did you have any coffee this morning?
I probably need a bit more coffee.
Okay.
But in any event, and then you'll notice the little code there, and then the expiration date. It expires on the 27th of October. And again, you know, that whole dates and all
yes,
of that.
Yes, we'll get
yeah,
to that.
Yeah, we'll talk to that. All right. Yeah, and then the last thing that I do want to mention here is you are going to notice that there is the live Q&A window. Susan and I are here. I just want to mention that that this is live. So it is the 23rd of September. It is presently 9:19 Pacific time. So again, this is live, being recorded live. So that Q&A window, we're going to try our best to answer as many questions as possible.
But it's us answering.
Exactly,
so.
Yeah.
If you see us talking, then we can't be answering. So
exactly.
We'll check on some breaks and things like that and
yeah.
try and come back. But please do be patient
yeah.
if we don't answer questions right away.
Yeah, we're sort of outnumbered here on the Q&A. There's a couple more people out there watching than are here. So just be cognizant of that. But we will answer questions. We will periodically incorporate questions. And we really want that dialogue.
Absolutely.
So yeah, absolutely. Cool. Well, hey, Susan.
Yes.
What do you say we get started?
Let's get started. I like it. That sounds like a good plan.
All right.
All right.
Are you driving slides or am I driving slides?
All right. Let me take over the slides then here. So let's get talking a bit about why you would get into coding and how you get started coding with Python and specifically since that's what we're doing here.
Mm-hmm.
So, I mean, why does someone learn to code? Really, it's because of what you can do with code. it's not that I have a complete and utter fascination with this weird syntax and these strange commands. But
well, maybe a little.
It's what I can do with the commands that makes it powerful.
Yep.
And really what it is, it's problem solving. Coding
yeah.
is just problem solving. That's the basic principle of what we're trying to do. So really, it comes down to what do you want to do?
Mm-hmm.
Whatever you want to do, whatever field you're entering or working in, coding can affect and help it.
Yep.
I've seen it in healthcare. I've seen it in physiotherapy. I have seen it in entertainment industry,
mm-hmm.
sports, everything. There's
yep.
not a field out there that isn't touched on by technology. So whether you want to build a phone app to help you find directions to the nearest coffee shop if you need that coffee, Christopher.
You're going to notice a caffeine
yes.
here today.
whether you want to calculate how much money you need to buy a car, you know, how much would a payment be if I,
yep.
you know, a $20,000 car or a $5,000 car over 5 years.
Mm-hmm.
Or maybe you have a small business and you're trying to figure out what people are saying about your business on social media. You could write your own code that would go out there and sort of collect tweets and
mm-hmm.
get summaries and things for you. It's incredible how much you can do with code. Or I've actually seen applications where somebody had used these new wearable devices that are out there now, this Internet
yep.
of Things. So you could like program some sort of wearable device so it tweets you when it's time to reapply your sunscreen.
Yes.
That's all doable.
Yeah.
I've actually seen premises of, devices that'll tell you when to put your sunscreen on.
Exactly.
Really
yeah. Cool. You know, automatically pick up the fact that you went for a run and automatically
yeah.
upload that to Facebook.
All those things.
Yeah.
Comes back to problem
yep.
solving with code.
Yeah.
Now, why Python in particular? The reason we chose Python for this particular session is because there are a lot of programming languages out there.
And it's funny, like, I'm looking through the Q&A right here, and there's, like, three questions about why Python? Why Python?
Yeah.
See?
There we
go.
All right.
Go.
Well, I'm so glad you asked.
Yeah. Funny you should mention that.
One of the reasons is Python is one of the easier programming languages to learn. It's actually becoming very popular. If you look at introduction to programming courses all over the place, you're seeing Python popping up more and more often. Some programming languages are extremely picky about syntax.
Mm-hmm.
And when you're just trying to learn the concepts and the basics of programming, you know, you've got enough to deal with without having to worry about every single space and comma that you put into the code. So Python's a little more forgiving than some of the other languages. The other advantage, lots of free tools out there you can use to code or learn Python.
Yep.
We're going to use Visual Studio with the Python tools of Visual Studio, specifically Visual Studio Express 2013 will work. So you can absolutely do it for free with the same tools we have here. But said the fact that it's free, right? Because you don't have to make an investment. You can start learning coding with Python without any cash investment. Said lots of tools out there to do it. And a lot of different ways you can use Python code. It's got a lot of different applications.
Yeah.
I was really quite amazed. I actually started doing a little bit of research. I mean, I poked around with the Python stuff, but I hadn't really appreciated how much you could do with it. And the other thing I want to make clear is even though we're focusing on Python here, once you learn the basics of coding, you'll be able to reapply those concepts in all programming languages.
Exactly.
Whether it's C# or JavaScript or C++ or Perl, any programming language you learn in the future, those fundamentals are just going to reappear over and over and over again.
Exactly. Every single programming language has variables. Every single programming language has an if statement. And that could be something like PowerShell. That could be something like Perl. That could be something like JavaScript. It could be, you know, they all have the same thing. And so once you learn those concepts, then it's just a matter of, oh, okay, here I have a curly brace, or here I have an end if, or whatever it is that it happens to be for the language. But now all you're doing is you're just picking up a few keywords. You already understand the concepts. So that's really one of our main focuses is going to be on those concepts.
Exactly.
Yep.
Now, I do want to make it clear, though. Teaching you Python doesn't mean you're not learning a language that's useful unto itself.
Right.
You can do a lot with Python itself.
Yep.
I said I was actually doing a little bit of research and discovered Industrial Light and Magic, who made the, you know, the Star Wars movies and so on.
Yep.
They actually use Python to help with their image processing when they're adding lighting and special effects.
Right.
So that's actually done using Python code.
Nice.
Forecastwatch.com uses Python on the back end to collect the information and to provide the information to provide a weather forecast.
Mm-hmm.
So that's done with Python. DevNet is one of those news sites, and they actually use Python to go out and collect different news information from different locations,
yep,
aggregate that information together,
aggregate,
and provide it to somebody through Python.
Yeah.
And this one I thought was the most amazing one. There was actually a student in England who was having some fun. There was a class of high school students. They were learning how to code using Python.
Mm-hmm.
And they set up a dinosaur and installed a little speaker in this plastic dinosaur and set up a Python program.
Yep.
So every time you tweeted a certain word, the little dinosaur would light up and roar.
Yeah.
You gotta have fun with code.
Absolutely, you gotta have a good time.
And if you do download the deck and you click on that link, you can see a video of the,
yep,
the little dinosaur roaring.
And actually, one little thing to kind of keep going with all of this and go back to the, you know, why Python, and you touched on it real briefly, is, you know, Python, it. One of the nice things about Python is there's a lot of things that it can do for you very simply, and there's a lot that you don't have to worry about. That there was a couple of questions in the chat window about dealing with things like memory management,
mm-hmm,
you know? And, you know, yes, there's going to be a day and a time where you'll have to go in and start worrying about all of that. Today's not that day. Right now is not that time. And the great thing is with Python, we really don't have to worry about that, or at least not for what we're going to be doing.
No, not.
So we're really trying to keep this as simple as possible. And kind of lower, you know, eliminate barriers.
Yes.
Yeah. You know,
lower the barrier.
Exactly.
It is lowering the barrier.
Yeah. Lowering the barrier to entry. That's really our big goal here.
Yeah. So I do want to make one thing very clear. If we can just go back to the slide for a second. You aren't going to learn enough in this 2-day course to start adding special effects to the next big superhero movie.
Now you tell me.
Yeah, I'm sorry about that. but you will learn enough to be able to start solving real world problems with code. So that you will do.
Mm-hmm.
So, and hopefully you'll start having fun because
exactly.
That's why we code.
Yeah.
I chose it as a career because I like coding. It
yeah.
is actually kind of fun once you get into it. Yes, there are moments you kind of want to bang your head against a wall because you can't figure out your little typing mistake. But, you know, you step away, you come back, go find a coffee if you need to.
Yes.
Yeah. So let's get into some straight logistics.
Yes.
How do I actually get started?
Yep.
We're going to use Python tools for Visual Studio. First, you are going to need to install some software on your PC or laptop. There are a lot of different tools out there you can use to write Python code. I saw a couple of comments in the window of people running on operating systems where they couldn't install Visual Studio 2012, 2013.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, you can go find. There's, you know, all kinds of tools out there. We're doing it with Visual Studio. You can, by all means, download another tool if that's not going to install on the operating system that you have in front of you.
Right.
It just means your interface is going to be a little different than ours. But what we're going to be doing is
the concepts will be the same.
The concepts will be the same. The code will be the same. Just difference in terms of what button you press to make it run, what
button
you press to create a new program.
Yep.
But what we're going to do is we're going to use Visual Studio and an add-on that was built by Microsoft called the Python Tools for Visual Studio, which is a really sweet set of tools. Mm-hmm. And the nice thing about using Visual Studio for this is if you do decide to learn other programming languages, you're not going to have to necessarily learn another tool. If you decide to learn C Sharp or C++, or you want to start building websites with HTML, you can do all of that inside Visual Studio. So that way you don't have to install six different tools on your desktop. You don't have to learn all these different interfaces. You mm-hmm. can keep working in the same tool. So yep. that's the other nice thing about using Visual Studio is once you've got that up and running, you can use it for a lot of different programming languages.
Yeah.
So how do you install it? And there is a Word document on the GitHub, and I'm hoping we've got a slide or something.
I can actually show right now.
Why don't you show the GitHub now? Because that might be useful.
Yeah, so if we kick over to my screen here, up there on the notepad, and I'll throw this into the chat window as well momentarily, you'll notice that it's going to be on the break slides, is this little shortcut URL, so akams/intro-python-code.
So aka.ms/intro-python-code.
Intro-python-code, yep. And I, again, we'll put that into the Q&A window here momentarily. And if you follow that, that will take you over to the GitHub, which is where we've uploaded all of our files. And the one thing that I would mention here is GitHub, for those of you who are not familiar, is a code repository. And this is where a lot of developers will go ahead and upload code for either sharing with other developers that they're actively working with, or for sharing with the general public, which is exactly what we're doing. So if you haven't necessarily played around or worked a whole lot with GitHub, don't worry too much about that. This is certainly a tool that you're going to be using in the future, if not necessarily right now. But this is just a very easy way for us to go ahead and share everything out. Now, if we kick back to the screen here, what you're going to notice right there, I've got my little download zip. And so if I just click that, it will say, hey, do you want to open or save? And I'm just going to go ahead and click open. Give that a second. And sure enough, there's the zip file with everything. Now, the couple of things that I want to highlight inside of here, number one is the solutions. And this is, and actually I'll kind of go back, and I didn't launch Zoomit.
Those are the solutions to the various...
We mentioned
there's going to be different challenges that you have to try after the individual chapters.
Yep.
So in that solutions directory, you're actually going to find the solution files for each one. So if you do get stuck on one, you can go take a look and see how we solved it. And then if you cheat and look at the solution, it's not really cheating. Many of us do it.
Yeah.
What I would suggest is look at the solution, then minimize it, and then try and write the code yourself.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Yep. Yeah. So that's where all of those are going to be. And then inside of Office Docs, this is where two big items are. Number one is all of the slides that that we're using. Now, keep in mind, we're just like typical presenters. These things may change as we go through today and tomorrow. It happens. So, you know, they may change a little bit. But where in the world? Why did you not sync? Ha, that's funny. Of course. It's probably on my end. I haven't synced it. But what will be up there momentarily, I can just show this right now, is the how to install Python tools. Yeah, that's it. I just didn't sync.
Yeah.
And this has the links that that Susan was highlighting in the slide. So Visual Studio for desktop and update 3. And the big thing here is you do want the desktop apps version for Visual Studio. So make sure you grab that. Again, you want update 3, install the Python tools that you can grab from there, and then the interpreter, and then away you go from there. So you will need all of those. If you're going to be doing Visual Studio, if you do want to use another product, you're, of course, free to do that. We're going to be doing everything with Visual Studio.
Yeah. I saw a couple of questions in the Q&A window about Visual Studio 2012 or earlier versions of Visual Studio. So just to be clear, you can use Visual Studio 2013 Express. That's the one we actually have a link to in the PowerPoint slide. If you are using Express, you have to have the most recent Visual Studio updates applied. Otherwise, you're not going to be able to use the Python tools for Visual Studio. You can run, if you happen to have Visual Studio 2012 Professional, one of the actual full versions of Visual Studio, yes, you can install Python tools for Visual Studio with Visual Studio 2012. It will not work with 2010 and those earlier editions. Mm-hmm. So if you are running 2010 Professional, you're going to want to download 2013 Express for desktop, so and the updates for that to make sure that you can use the Python tools from Visual Studio. So hopefully that helps with a few of you who are having some problems. So first thing to check is make sure you have the updates to Visual Studio. You're running at least 2012, and if it's Express, it has to be 2013. Then you install the Python tools from Visual Studio. And then after that, when you try to, you will also need to install an interpreter, because Python is a language that has to be converted to machine language by an actual interpreter. Mm-hmm. So when you're writing Python code, the computer doesn't understand Python code. The interpreter basically translates the Python code into a language the computer speaks. And that's what the interpreter is doing.
Exactly. Yep.
Yeah. All right. Now, oh, I did want to throw in one little,
yes.
You know, one of the fun things about being a coder, well, okay, maybe this says something to our personalities, but we learn to speak geek so you can understand the conversations people are having. So when you start exploring more of Python, you're going to start seeing stuff about CPython and IronPython and PyPy and Jython and so on. There's actually a lot of different variations on Python. Mm-hmm. The basic syntax concepts we cover here apply to all of them. There might be some slight differences in syntax, but really everything we cover here is going to apply. So we're going to be using, for the record, so you can impress your friends, well, I was learning CPython with the Python 3.4 interpreter. So that's the version we'll be working with.
Okay, all right.
Yeah, if anybody was to ask you, you're learning IronPython or PyPy, you're learning CPython specifically. And why that's significant and why that's going to affect you is, let's say you're a lazy programmer, like certain people you might meet today.
Nobody at this desk, though. Nobody here. No.
So if you are a lazy programmer like I am, one of the things you find yourself doing is you'll discover that chances are whatever you want to do, someone's already written the code to do it.
The best code in the world is the code that's already written. You know, there's a friend of mine that likes to say, we're not launching rockets here. And what he means when he says that is that whatever it is that we're doing, somebody else has already done. Yeah. Feel free to take advantage of that.
Yeah, and programmers are actually incredibly generous about mm-hmm. sharing the code they've written. There'll be blog posts with examples of how exactly do I do the following. And so you'll go and you'll start searching around for how do I send a message to this wearable device to make my dinosaur roar.
Yep.
And you'll go searching it and you'll find the result. And somebody will have posted a sample of code that does what you want to do. Now, it's possible when you take that code and you try it, you're going, it's giving me errors. Now, it may be that the code they posted has mistakes in it. That's been known to happen. But it might be they're working with IronPython and you were doing CPython. So you might find some slight syntax differences when you're looking at Python code examples because of all the different variations. It's not going to be huge differences.
Exactly.
It might be that a method name is different.
Yeah.
But just a heads up, if you're copying and pasting someone else's code and it doesn't work, wait a second, you're using CPython, what were they using?
Yep.
You might find some differences.
Exactly.
So then you get to search for what's this command in JPython or IronPython, what's the equivalent in CPython?
Exactly. Bing is your friend. Stack Overflow is your friend.
Oh, yes.
By the way, one real quick thing, I just want to kick back to my screen again, just because I want to highlight this just one last time.
Sure.
Again, you know, the URL, and it is in the chat window, and I'll throw it in there a couple more times, and it is going to be on the break slides as well. But I do now want to highlight that I did do my last sync. So if I go back in, remember, it's download zip, and I'll kind of zoom in on that. Yeah, download zip. That's going to give you all the files inside of there, and if I click open, and now, if I go into the Office docs, there are the ones that that I was talking about. So I just needed to sync
Absolutely.
Those up.
Yeah.
And I'll also mention that this is going to be the repository where Susan and I will be uploading all of our sample code so that as we do our demonstrations, and by the way, we are going to be doing our demonstrations live. Here's our apology. Something's going to break. There. I said it.
Yep.
Just get it out of the way. But as we go through this, periodically we'll be uploading to GitHub and make it all available up there.
Yeah, so any code you see us doing here, we'll try to make sure that's all available to you later. So if you want to go back and look at it and go, wait a second, I know they did that, it'll be there for you.
Exactly, yep.
So now, Christopher.
Yes,
I believe I have everything set up on my computer.
Okay.
I have installed Visual Studio 2013.
Yep.
I have installed the most recent updates.
Okay.
I have installed Python tools for Visual Studio.
Okay.
And I've installed the interpreter.
Okay.
Now,
yep.
You've learned the occasional programming language in the past.
Yep.
How do I make sure I've installed everything right and it's going to work?
You write hello world. You make your computer display Hello World. Now, while Susan's getting Visual Studio up here, I'll just kind of mention for those of you who are new to developers, this is sort of the initiation that the first program that you ever write in any language or in any environment is, by tradition, Hello World. And actually, if you head on out to Bing, you'll notice that there are websites that will show you how to do Hello World in basically any programming language. This is just sort of, this is the way we get people in.
It is like an initiation, but it's also actually really, and it's sort of silly, and it's almost a running joke amongst programmers. Yep. Oh, we're going to write Hello World. But it really serves an important purpose, because it's a way of just making sure of it. Yeah, you have got the tools installed correctly, and you can write a line of code and it will run. Because if Hello World doesn't work and you start trying to write a really big complicated program and it doesn't work, you won't know, is the error coming up because your code was wrong or because things aren't installed correctly. So once you see that Hello World up and running, you get to give a little, victory moment.
Absolutely.
And say, okay, now I get to start having fun, because now I can start writing cool code.
Yep.
So how do we do Hello World? So if we can just go to my machine over here. I have Visual Studio up and running on my computer. And when you're doing this at home, you are going to go to File, New Project. And when this pops up, you're going to see a number of different project types you can create. You know, Visual Basic projects, C# projects. As I mentioned, Visual Studio, one of the cool things about it is you can actually do a lot of different programming languages. But we're focusing in on Python today. So if I select Python, then on the right-hand side, you see a number of different types of projects. Mm-hmm. As I also mentioned earlier, Python can be used for a lot of different things. So you can actually do Iron Python instead of CPython if you want to in Visual Studio. You can use it for web applications. You can use it for Windows Forms applications. So there's a lot of different ways you can use it. The project type we're going to use on this particular MVA is Python application. So that's the project type you're going to want to select. And then what becomes important is you're going to want to go in and type in a name for your application. Got a suggestion for a name, Christopher?
Oh, let's see. We're going to have the screen display Hello World. Let's go with Hello World.
Hello World. All right. So let's go with Hello World as our project name. And then you pick a location where you want your file to be stored. Mm-hmm. You'll notice mine saves to this little repository. That's because it's saving everything I'm doing to GitHub so you guys can access it later. So you save it anywhere you want on your machine so you can locate it when you want it. And once you have that done, you can go ahead and say OK. And Visual Studio will go off and it'll actually create a project. And on the right-hand side over here, I'm just going to zoom in a little bit over here and show you a bit around the Solution Explorer. And what you're going to see inside there, what is it, Control-Shift to, I got to remember how to do this. Chris is better with zoom it than I am. There we go.
There you go.
So one of the things you'll be able to see in there is this Python file called helloworld.py. The files with the .py extension are the files that contain your Python code. So that's the most important file for you to work with. And that file there is actually, just get back, is actually the file I can see open over here. This is my code editor window where I write and modify my code. And I think the guys who created the Python tools for Visual Studio had a sense of humor, because by default, when you create a brand new project in Python for Visual Studio, it actually gives you the code for Hello World. So I don't even need to type. They must be lazy programmers
Exactly, yes. They realized that you were going to do this demo and decided, you know what, we're just going to make Susan's life easier. Just here, have some code, Susan.
Exactly. So print Hello World is the command that will print the message Hello World on the screen. So all I need to do is figure out how to run it. So if we go back to Visual Studio, there's two different ways that I can run this code. If you are a keyboard person, and the more you get into coding, the more you're going to get fond of keyboard shortcuts. There is this debug, start debugging, will launch your program and start it executing. Or you can say start without debugging. So the F5 key or control and the F5 key will launch your program. So if I just hit the F5 key, up pops a window saying Hello World, press any key to continue. I have successfully run a Hello World program.
Mazel tov.
Woohoo. Now, if, on the other hand, if you're a mouse person, not a keyboard person, there is a little button at the top of the screen up here. And if you take a look there, you can actually see, there we go, there's our little start button. Mm-hmm. So you can also click on that start button to launch your program as well. Just depends what you prefer. Just pick the method that you find easier. You may find, I might switch back and forth. I'm not necessarily consistent. Sometimes I'll use the function key. Sometimes I'll press that start button. Once you do launch it, it's up and running. Now you need to know how to shut it down again. And once again, there's a few different ways you can do it. I love the fact it gives you a hint right on the screen.
Press the any.
Press a key. Oh, look, it shut down the program. The other option is you can close the window. Just like if you were in Word or Excel, right? Close the window when you're done. The other way of shutting it down is inside Visual Studio. If I go over here, you'll take a look. And once again, you can see a little button there, the stop button. Think of it like a VCR. Play to start playing your program, stop to stop your program.
VCR?
Oh, yeah, DVD player, sorry. I'm dating myself again. So you can hit that stop button to stop executing as well. Now, this is actually a little Visual Studio coding world tip that helps you out, is once in a while, you might have this window open, and then you do something like go checking your email. And you forget that the program is still running.
I have done this so many times.
So you start going here and making changes, and maybe something's not acting, because it will actually let you modify the code. That's actually one of the neat features of Visual Studio, is you can actually make modifications while your code is still running, which is kind of freaky when you think about it. But it's really, actually, you'll learn to love that feature. Mm-hmm. But every now and then, there might be certain changes you're making, and it'll say, well, what are you trying to do? The code's still running. And you'll be going, why am I getting that error message? Now here's the thing, there's a cue that can help you remember your code is still running. So if we return to Visual Studio one last time, look in the top right corner up here and see how that stop button appears. That only shows up in red if your code is actively running. Once you hit that button, it's gone. So once you stop executing the code, aha, I know that my code is not running right now. So
right.
If you see that stop button, if something weird is happening, take a glance. See if you see that little stop button, go, oh, my code's still running. Hit the stop button. We'll probably do it at some point during this MVA.
Yep.
It'll hit us sometime.
Yeah.
So don't panic. Just check and see if your code's still running.
Exactly.
And we now have our Hello World.
Yes.
So we've basically created our first application.
We have. Well done.
Yeah. And I think that just brings us to... Maybe you want to mention, we should mention a couple of best practices, because I think it's really important to get into good habits right away when you're coding.
You know, whenever I'm doing any form of an intro to fill-in language here, and this could be SQL, C#, Python, anything like that, I probably spend a good third of the time just talking about best practices that to go with a golf analogy, that if you're ever going to go learn to golf, and basically don't do what most people do, including myself, which is decide, hey, I'm going to take up golf and just head out and, you know, just start whacking on some balls. The problem is that you're learning bad habits right from the get-go. And so when you're under stress, what's going to happen is you're going to revert back to those bad habits. And the exact same thing holds true here, that this is the perfect time to start to develop those good habits, because the habits that you develop now are the ones that are going to follow you throughout the rest of your career. Yeah.
So one of the good habits we want to pick up is the idea of commenting your code.
Yes.
Have you ever had a situation, Christopher, where you wrote a program and then you had to come back to it maybe 3 months later to make a change and you found yourself going, what was I doing?
3 minutes later. I always like to say I have a great memory. It's just really short. The number of times where I've written something out and then go back to it later and I start to go, why in the world? Or the other one that gets me is I'll go in and I'll look at my code and I'll go, you know, why did I do it that way? It would have been much easier if I would have done it this way. And I'll go back in and I'll start recoding it and I'll get about halfway through. And all of a sudden I realize, oh, that's why, because, you know, whatever the reason was. And so if you throw in those little comments, those kind of messages in a bottle, it makes it that much easier to remember later on exactly what it was you were doing. On top of that, I would also say this, for those of you that are brand new to Python, this is a great way to take notes.
Yes.
So that you go ahead, you write out a little bit of Python that does whatever it is that it does, and then right on top of it, you put in a comment that explains what that code is about to do.
Yep, that'll help you reinforce things.
Yep.
And the other advantage to it is, one of the other things that'll happen the more you get into coding is you may find yourself coding and someone else is coding, and you're looking at someone else's code, or someone else is looking at your code. And I can tell you, I have yet to meet a program that somebody handed me that had too many comments. When I'm trying to, and it's bad enough that I have trouble reading my own code 6 months later. When I'm trying to understand someone else's code, that can be really remarkably difficult to try and understand and follow through what someone's done. And you're going to notice this very quickly. You're going to appreciate those code examples which have comments. So,
yes.
Let's try and create another generation of people who do put comments in their code. You'll hear about the principles of self-documenting code, people who argue you don't need comments. I like comments. Please put them in there for me. I appreciate it.
Yep.
So.
Yeah.
So you can put in information about what your program does, what a particular command does. You might have written a little note saying, hey, I used this command instead of that command because I discovered the following.
Yeah, that's the big one, yeah.
And also said anything that would help someone understand why you did something the way you did. And the syntax in Python for using comments is the pound symbol or a hashtag.
Mm-hmm.
So anything in Python where the line starts with that pound or hashtag is going to be completely ignored when the code is executed. It's basically going to say, oh, those are just notes for you. Okay, fine, I'll ignore those.
Yep.
So if I go back to, let me go to Visual Studio again, and let's just do a little example. So we go here, and I can add a nice little comment here saying this is a comment.
Ooh, pretty color.
And and I can add lots of comments.
Yep.
And you brought up the point of the color. That's a really good point there, Christopher. One of the other nice things about Visual Studio is it actually uses color coding
mm-hmm.
to help us keep track of what we've typed in. So when you look at this code here inside Visual Studio, you'll notice that the comments are all in green. And some of the other sort of neat things that you've got going here is you've got, if we take a look here, I'm going to try this sort of, nope, touch isn't working for me. Let's do it this way. So you can actually see that the string, mm-hmm. so the string of text that's going to be displayed shows up in red. That's Visual Studio's way of saying, hey, I recognize that's a string of text. The word print here, actually shows up in black. That's a way of saying, oh, that's one of your commands that you're using.
Yep.
That color coding, you'll find useful at helping you find those occasional mistakes that haunt programmers.
Yeah, occasional.
So you'll find that really useful, that different sort of color coding. Now, here's a cool little geek tip, because we've got to have some fun, show you some neat little things so you
yep.
can impress your other geek friends. If you don't like the colors, I actually find that green sometimes a little bit hard to read for the comments.
Yeah, that's a little light.
In the very top right corner of Visual Studio, there is a little box, and it's called the Quick Launch. And if you go there and you type the word font, it'll actually bring up a pop-up menu, and what this does is it actually searches the tool itself and tells you where in the tool you can change a setting. So I can go here to find out how do I change information mm-hmm. about the fonts and the colors of my code editor.
Yep.
So I go, oh, look at this. Under options, I can change environment, fonts, and colors. If we click on that, I'm going to zoom back out again here. You'll see that I can change things like my font size. So if you want the text to be bigger, I've got it set to 16, a little bit large, but that's because we're doing a presentation. You probably have it something smaller at home. And I can do things like I can go down and I can say, you know what, for my comments, I would like the default color to maybe be purple mm-hmm. instead of green, because maybe that's a darker color and easier for me to see and distinguish. And you can make it bold if you want to, and you can give it a lovely yellow background, and that would be quite hideous.
Let's not do that.
Yeah, let's not do that. But really, and it gives you a sample of how it would appear here, but it's wonderful that you do have that ability to customize it, and I'm going to leave it, set it back to the default for now, which is green, just because I don't want to mess you up. I want to match what's on the slides. But you can change it to anything that you like. So you really can customize that look and feel inside Visual Studio. It's
yep.
one of the nice features of the product. And I think, as we do that, so we've talked about the colors.
Yep.
You know what? I think if
yeah.
you have got that working, you are now a coder. Once you see that hello world appearing on the screen, add a comment,
yep.
you are now a coder.
And I do want to just real quickly here, first of all, let's not downplay this.
Mm-hmm.
Number one, congratulations. If you get something to print out on the screen, you're a coder.
Yes.
You know, it's like Susan and I both run. You know, sometimes people will say, oh, I'm not really a runner because I haven't done fill-in distance here. If you run, you're a runner.
Yes.
If you write code, you're a coder. It's
yep.
very simple. There is no, you know, nobody's like, you know, asking you to bring in a portfolio to, you know, confirm that you are or are not a coder. I mean, if you're going for a job, but that's something completely
yeah.
different, you know? But as far as whether or not you're a coder, hey, you're a coder. Yes.
So.
The other thing I do want to mention real quickly here, just because there's still been a fair amount of questions in the chat window, I just want to throw it up one more time. There's again the URL. And again, the big button here that I want to highlight is this button right here, download zip.
That's the easy way to get
That's
everything.
That's the easy way to get everything.
Yeah.
So, like I said, periodically, this is going to be, we're going to go in and update all of this. All that you have to do when you want to go get the latest files that we've played with, just click download zip, and that will go get everything for you. In fact, I actually did make one little change. There was one mistake in the Word document, the link to download Visual Studio.
Okay.
So I just went in and updated that. So again, that's the easiest thing to do. Don't worry about syncing or anything like that. If you are curious, I have to do this.
Okay.
We do have an MVA on using Git and Visual Studio that you can go check out, but that's so far beyond what we're going to be doing. This really is it, is just simply hit download zip down there at the very bottom, and that will give you everything that you need.
All right, so I think we are we have come to an end of Module 1.
Yeah, we have coders.
Yes, excellent.
Yes.
Congrats, folks. You're coding.
Yeah. All right, so what do you say we take 10 minutes, we'll come on back, and then we'll start to take that first step beyond Hello World.
Now we'll start solving problems with our code.
Yes, excellent. We'll see you guys in 10 minutes.